Hello everyone, I'm Li Xinyuan, a lecturer at Huawei. We just compared different security strategies, and now we will start with the content of Lesson 8, which is about network access control. First, let's introduce the concept of NAC, Network Admission Control, Network Access Control. It sounds very sophisticated in English, but it's actually about how clients and the network authenticate each other, ensuring that legitimate users connect to legitimate networks. That's what it means. Here we involve two systems. One is the NAC we just mentioned, used for interaction between users and access devices. That is, the interaction between users and APs, access points. Of course, here we need to control the access methods, which will include those different strategies we talked about, and then ensure that our users can access the network properly. And the second thing is 3A. 3A stands for authentication, authorization, and accounting, which are acronyms for these three English words. 3A, as we mentioned, the radius server, is used to verify user passwords. It is actually a type of 3A, used to determine if our users are eligible to connect to our network, and if they are eligible to use our network resources. This is the relationship between NAC and 3A. 3A, authentication, authorization, and accounting. Authentication, authorization, and accounting. These are used to determine if our users are eligible to access the network. Radius is one of the most commonly used protocols to implement 3A. Let's take a look at this topology. Our users connect to the network through the AP. But can this user access the internet? This user sends information from the switch to the AC, and then the AC uses radius to interact with our radius server using the radius protocol to verify this user, to evaluate the information sent by this user, to see if they are eligible to connect to our network. If they are, the AC will grant access to this user, and then the user can access the internet normally. This protocol is based on UDP. Its layer 4 protocol is based on UDP, and it uses ports 1812 and 1813 for authentication and accounting. This radius protocol is now used by most operators, including their broadband services. Most of them use this radius protocol. Radius protocol we use is a client-server model. Who is the client? The user is the client, the user is our connecting client, but it's only nominally the client. In reality, for the radius protocol, our client is actually the AC. Why? Because it is the AC that gets the user's message and asks radius if this person can access the internet. So, from the perspective of radius, our AC is the client. And this radius also supports secure messaging. It also supports interaction mechanisms and good scalability, making it a very important protocol in the access domain, radius. Next, let's look at the 802.1x authentication. When you see 802, you might think of it as a protocol developed by the IEEE organization, a typical client-server structure, including the requester, the authenticator, and the authentication server, which is the radius server we just mentioned. Let's look at this topology. Our user terminal is the requester. The user wants to access the internet, so it initiates authentication. Then the AC goes to the radius. The AC acts as the client of the radius protocol, and the authentication server is the server of the radius protocol. In this way, if authentication is passed, the AC will grant access. Finally, the user terminal can communicate with the network. This is what is called 802.1x authentication. This authentication is somewhat similar to broadband's PPPoE. Combined with radius authentication, not much more to say here. This 802.1x authentication, you should know, involves a radius server, our AC, acts as the client to radius. Acting as the client to the radius, besides what we just discussed, regarding 802.1x, we also have MAC authentication. This MAC authentication is relatively easy to understand. Each device has a unique MAC address. When this device connects to an AP, the AP will know this device's MAC address, right? Once it detects this MAC address, our AC will use this MAC address to consult the server, asking the server, can this person access the internet? In the AC, we need to pre-configure some parameters, letting the AC know which MAC addresses can access the internet and which cannot. The biggest feature of this authentication, as you can see here, you don't need to enter anything because your MAC address is written in your device's network card. It's embedded in your terminal. So for devices that are not user interactive, this kind of authentication is very suitable. And our MAC authentication also supports that after the first user authentication, you can be exempt from authentication for a certain period of time. This combines portal and MAC. First, you authenticate through the portal, then the device remembers your MAC address. Then a timer is activated during this period. As long as your MAC address is detected, I will let it pass directly. This usage is also supported. So, to give the user a good experience, we need to plan our services flexibly. As we discussed earlier, MAC can be combined with portal authentication. Let's see how they are combined. What is portal authentication? Portal authentication, you've surely all used it in large shopping malls, airports, or high-speed train stations. After connecting to the Wi-Fi, you are redirected to a web page. On that page, you usually need to enter your mobile number, then receive a verification code, and then enter that code. After that, you can use the network resources in medium to large enterprises, commercial exhibitions, public places, especially in public places. Most use this type of portal authentication, and when using it, you see, we have two methods to facilitate access. This authentication is most commonly used at high-speed train stations, or at airports, of course. If it's a corporate environment, we have this method as well, where administrators can allow visitors to temporarily apply for an account. And this account has a time limit in our system. After some time, it might expire, and you would need to reapply. That's portal authentication just now. We said, portal authentication can also be combined with MAC. How are they combined? You can first authenticate via SMS, allowing the user into the network, and then immediately after, let our server remember the user's MAC address. For a certain period, as long as this MAC address comes up, it means they were already verified before, so we don't need to re-verify, just let them through. This is combining portal with MAC. This is the MAC prioritized portal authentication I just mentioned. Let's take a look. Firstly, our portal authentication must be successful, and then, within a certain time, even if there is a dynamic network reconnection, as long as our MAC address is recorded, there is no need to enter the username and password again. This makes it very convenient to use, generally speaking, in our large public spaces. This setup is usually present. Once you've authenticated once, even if you restart your phone, you can still continue to access the internet without needing to re-authenticate. Now let's compare the three different authentication methods we've discussed. 802.1x, MAC authentication, and portal 802.1x is relatively newer, and it generally has higher requirements for devices. Let's take a look. It has specific requirements for the client, and it offers very high security, but it is not flexible enough in deployment, whereas MAC authentication, the most important aspect is it supports dumb terminal logging, requiring no interaction, just send your MAC address to me, and I'll know whether you can access the internet. But we are in the back end and the front end. While the front end user experience is convenient, the back end has a lot of work to do. You at least need to register the MAC address. And we know MAC addresses are a long string, right? If there are a lot of devices, registering them can be quite cumbersome. Finally, the portal authentication, which is also very common, this authentication method, is relatively more flexible in deployment, but in terms of security, it definitely doesn't match the security level of 802.1x authentication. Thus, in places with strict requirements, like large enterprises, for example, a corporate R&D center, they usually use this method. Portal authentication, however, along with MAC authentication, often gets organically combined. These are our three different authentication methods. We've discussed different authentication methods, 802.1x, and portal authentication. That concludes the eighth section. Next, we will discuss how WLAN security configurations are implemented, how we set up WLAN security.